So you asked about Kendrick Lamar verse, the King of New York, and I guess the question is what I think about it. I haven't heard the verse. I haven't listened to Kendrick Lamar, but I don't like his rap. I think he's a talented MC. But I haven't heard the verse. I've heard more about people talking about it and being upset about it than those that were really digging it up. But my thing is that, I'm not going to be moved by someone who calls himself the King of New York. If that's what he feels, that's what he feels. You know, Run DMC once said they were the King of Rock. They didn't have Guns N' Roses and Led Zeppelin and Earl Smith and all these other groups coming at them, AC/DC and Kiss. But they said they were the King of Rock, you know? And I really didn't have a problem with him calling himself the King of New York at all.
Good question.
To think beautiful thoughts. Because that's the least of the mind is to think beautiful thoughts.
Woo!
Next question.
Sometimes the thought takes years to build, sometimes weeks. I think of a subject or I'll take a word and I write it down and then I try to figure out a way to put that word or that thought into a sentence and make it as strong as possible. Also layer it 2, 3, 4, 5 times so it has double, triple, and quadruple meaning. And not in a complex way. Complexity, but simplicity also. And sometimes I would just write sentences on a piece of paper and one after another, and the second one may not have anything to do with the third, and the third may not have anything to do with the fourth, so I may take the first and match it with the 22nd and put it together. And
genius!
Sort of like a puzzle.
Next question. If
that's what he thinks, then that's what he is. I'm not saying he isn't. I think there's a genius within all of us and a poetic side in all of us. But there are not too many geniuses that actually call themselves geniuses.
Yeah!
Depends. Are you climbing on a clock?
No.
I mean, you know, it's all fair. tell you, Chuck Chang, you last from anywhere from 30 minutes to 30 days. You know, I once had a, well, I have a brother who used to play his son, but my brother was incarcerated, and they used to play through letters. So each letter was one move. So imagine how long that took. It all depends.
My girl.
So I think I speak for a lot of musicians here when I say, you know, when we started out working on our music, we did it because we loved it, for whatever reason it was, you know, we felt really connected with it, we felt like we could express ourselves with it, our identity, whatever it was. And then a lot of us musicians, we also dream of hopefully being in your position one day where music has become our life, where we don't have to work anymore, where music is our life. So my question for you is, what was the defining moment when it went from one to the other? When it went from the music that you love and felt connected with to this is what I want to do with my life?
That was probably around the age of 18. We were making demos, running around the boroughs of New York, battling a lot of MCs, putting out dudes, and like I said, unlikely confrontation, the clash of swords. And we were running around battling, and by the time hip hop was growing and engulfing every home that had housed a youth, we decided to try to shop out demos and get a deal. So that was in the 80s, maybe like 84 and 85. And in 1989, 4 years later, which seemed like 20 years later, because we were going to record labels and we were sending letters and demos and we weren't getting answers and we were trying to make calls, and it was a struggle for us trying to get on. But by the time in 85 is when I decided this is what I want to do. In 89, 90 is when I got my first deal. 91 is when I put out my first record. But I was young and I had that thought in my mind, but as I got older, you know, you still have to work and get a job and take care of yourself. I mean, music was always first love for me, but when you're dealing with reality, it's secondary, because you still have to pay bills. You know, you're not making, I mean, I was fortunate enough to have a career for 20-something years in hip-hop. You know, something that was a childhood passion started in lobbies, quick and fast. And I was fortunate enough to, but a lot of us are not that fortunate, and it's hard. I mean, I once heard someone say, I don't know how true it is, statistically, that it's easier to get into the NBA than be successful in hip hop, like rap album. So, you know, find ways of, I mean, we have internet now, we have different ways of really getting your music out there. I mean, you know, you can post videos online, there's ways of being discovered and noticed, which we didn't have those methods back in the day. But, you know, you can't be 22, 32, just depending on trying to get a deal and not supporting yourself. Make it a secondary thing, you know, but keep it number one in your heart.
Hi, as someone who has studied in university English and poetry for 4 years now, I've always been fascinated with the poetic aspect of your music, and this goes well with the young man's question. Your music and your poetry often comes across as has a very intrinsic stream of consciousness style, and I'm wondering how often you actually write in a stream of consciousness style, and when you do, how often do you go back and review and revise that, or do you find that detracts from the sincerity and the candidness of your lyrics?
I don't think it detracts. I always write like that, regardless of what I'm writing about. I can be writing about a piece of paper blowing in the wind. There's going to be some sort of consciousness attached to the rhyme. And I always go back to it. I draft and redraft and draft all this stuff. I write about 5 drafts per rhyme. Some rhymes take me a month to write. Some take me a month to research and gather the notes to put it together. And sometimes it may take a week, but I'm always going over and drafting until I feel it's good. And even when I get it and record it, I may look back at it 2 years, you know, later, looking back on it and say, I could have done better than that.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thank you.
Hey, cousin of mine, his name was Light. Light from y'all from the desert, Queens. We were staying together. You know, actually, my first cousin, so we lived together for like the majority of our lives in the early part. And at this time, I had moved to Staten Island. I would travel from Staten Island to Queens. And he's about 3 or 4 years older. Him and his brother Shaquem, you know, had given me knowledge. But before then, my sister had a husband who used to have these lessons under the bed. And they used to have these, I don't know if you ever seen people who agree that they were kind of old, and you have the man standing and they would say knowledge, and then like, they had something that earth would be denial. And sometimes I would sneak them his lessons and read them and learn them. But it was my cousin Light who had first introduced me to the knowledge itself.
Peace.
And then I was taught by my brother Almighty Nicholas about peace. Peace. All right,
we got one more question.
It's actually about your speech. There was a part in it that really resonated with me with regard to the violent behavior of the world affecting our violent behavior as a people. I was wondering if you also feel that the understanding of the opposite of what you said is true, that maybe the violent behavior of us affecting the violent behavior of the world, and how we can change that.
I do believe that's true. I mean, that's where it starts. There's a saying, there's also a song, people makes the world go around. And, you know, everything comes from thought, which our actions come after. And I do think our behavior and the way these things has an effect on the earth and the universe itself. I mean, there's also been proven, scientists have studied this, that they looked at the activity of humans and then study the activity of earth, and it's almost like a mirror image of what the earth is doing based on what people are doing.